Hi, and welcome to our live stream. We'll be starting shortly, but let me just encourage you to tune in, to get comfortable, and we really hope that you have a blessed experience worshiping with us this morning, or whenever you're tuning into this. Hi, and welcome to our live stream. We'll be starting shortly, but let me just encourage you to tune in, to get comfortable, and we really hope that you have a blessed experience worshiping with us this morning, or whenever you're tuning into this.
My name's Stephen. I'm one of the home group leaders here at Downshire Church. At Downshire, we feel that home groups are an essential part of growing in your faith. It's a safe place to come and ask questions, to fellowship, and to delve deeper into God's Word. Our home group at the minute attends the Carlisle Hall at church at 7:30 to 8:30 on a Wednesday evening. It would be great to see as many new faces as possible. Hopefully see you there. Thank you.
Hi everyone. Just want to give you a wee bit of info regarding our home group. We meet every Tuesday evening about 8:30. We meet via Zoom. And the main reason why we meet via Zoom is simply because we have a lot of people in our group that are couples who are parents of kids. And it gives us a great opportunity to all get together and just really meet up and to share God's word.
We find home group just really, really helpful. It's a great way to have a bit of extra support during your week, a chance to really have fellowship together and to pray for each other and just to dive a bit deeper into the word. Thanks.
Whenever I'm asked to describe what it's like in house group, a passage often comes to mind from 1 Kings chapter 19. Then a great and powerful wind tore the mountain apart and shattered the rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. After the wind there was an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. After the earthquake came a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire came a gentle whisper. When Elijah heard it, he pulled off his cloak over his face and went out and stood on the mountain of the cave. Here is a description of a frightened, lonely man. Many of us today are frightened and afraid. We are listening for the still, small voice of God. If you want to hear that voice, please come along to our Bible study. Wednesday, 7:30, in Carlisle Hall. You're more than welcome.
My name is Andrea, and I help lead home group with my husband Alan on a Wednesday night at 8 p.m.
So, we are a very friendly bunch with a fair range of ages, young to sort of like young-ish.
Life's so busy, and this time on a Wednesday night really helps us to kind of just take a step back and just to focus on the real reasons why we're here and just our Christian faith and how we can encourage each other. So
we will hopefully be meeting using the facilities down at the church for a little while to give us a chance to actually meet face to face once again.
Home group is really simply a time where we each encourage each other in our Christian faith.
Hi, we're Hannah and Adam Cray. We host a home group on Tuesday evenings at 8 o'clock. Currently we're meeting up at church, and our group is made up of a varied age range of people from all different experiences of church and faith, and we really love the dimension that brings.
Yeah, one of the reasons we really love leading a home group is just it's where the rubber really hits the road when it comes to doing life together. And getting to ask those awkward questions, maybe dive deeper into your Bible, but ultimately just growing in relationship with each other and diving deeper into our relationship with God.
Yeah, we would love for you to join us.
Good morning and welcome to Downshire Church. We are delighted to have you worship with us this morning. Whether you've been a member of our church family for years, whether you joined us recently, or whether you're just an occasional visitor, you are so welcome and we're so glad to have you gather with us to worship this morning. I pray that this morning's service God will use to speak to you as individuals. And so as we come and start our worship service this morning, let us pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you for this opportunity to gather to worship. I pray now that you will still our hearts, that you will help us to focus on you, and that we will hear the message you have for each of us this morning.
Hi, and welcome to our live stream. We'll be starting shortly, but let me just encourage you to tune in, to get comfortable, and we really hope that you have a blessed experience worshiping with us this morning, or whenever you're tuning into this.
good morning, everybody. My name's Debbie. I'm one of the elders here in the church, and I would just like to welcome you this morning to the service, whether you're worshipping at home or here in the church, a very big welcome, and it's lovely to see everybody today. So I'm going to do the wee children's address now, okay? Now, boys and girls, I'm going to talk a wee bit about sin, okay? We know what it's like. We go through life, we all pick up nasty little sin stains. What are sins? Well, sins are things that we do wrong and things that are in the Bible that God has told us not to do, okay? But we keep doing them time and time again. And then we end up, we're covered in sin stains, just like this glove, okay? I'm going to try and do a little experiment to tell you who can take away our sins, okay? So, here I have a basin. Here I have a sin-stained glove, and that's hard to say, sin-stained. So, I'm going to put that in my basin, and I've got this soap powder called Strong Man Soap Powder. Sorry, Nathan? Oh. That's like you?
That's my photo.
That's your photo, that's right. So anyway, I thought, yeah, Strong Man Soap Powder, that should do the trick. It says on the back here, so strong, it cleans everything as white as snow, removes all stains. Happy days. So let's give it a go. Our stained, sin-stained glove. A little drop of water, I'll not use too much now because I don't want to soak the place. Okay. And we'll give it a good wash. Get those sin stains away. Let's try hard as we can. Grit the teeth and all. Oh dear. Not working. Try it again because they're really ground in, you know, because they've been there such a long time and the sin stains happen over and over again. So I'll try it yet again. Come on. Some more powder. Try it again. Ain't working. What am I going to do now? Ah, I know. I've got this other powder, and it's called Miracle Wash. So I'll maybe try it. So here we go. Miracle Wash, here we go again. Little drop of water. Some more Miracle Wash. Grind in, give them a good scrub. Wow, is that awesome? Miracle Wash has done the trick. I've now got a lovely clean white glove. Boys and girls, I'm sure you're wondering, what is this Miracle Wash? You know, I would want it, you know, what is it? But can I just tell you, the Miracle Wash is Jesus. Jesus died on the cross to take away all our sins, and he is a Miracle Wash. He can take away our sins, but don't take my word for it, boys and girls. Try it for yourself. Talk to Jesus. Ask him to forgive. Ask him to forgive your sins. So we need to turn to Jesus. We need to ask him to forgive us all our sins. He will wash away our sins and make us clean and as white as snow. Okay, so if any boys and girls at church, if they want to just go out to the children's church. Okay? Help me take this.
Big thank you to Debbie, and just maybe a special note to a big thanks to Debbie and Hannah, who have been really just they've been knocking it out of the park. I'm sure you'll agree with our kids ministry, not just over here, but with our kids addresses. And personally, I am so grateful to you guys, but also I know that the church is. And sometimes you can assume that people know what effect that their ministries are having, and you feel like you don't need to tell them, but tell them. Give them a wee text, a wee phone call. Just let them know what their ministries mean to you and to your kids, because they put so much work into them, and it's really great. So thank you guys for that. So good morning, everyone. If you're joining us on live stream or in person, we pray that you feel welcome, part of this family. If you're a visitor here, we pray that you feel part of the furniture as well. We're not a membership club. We are a people who belong to Jesus. And so we join not just with each other at home, but we join with people across Carrick, across Northern Ireland, across the globe, in declaring that Jesus is King. A few announcements. So this is going to start off our new season of teaching in Galatians. But on that, we're then starting our new season of home groups as well. So home groups are going to be meeting again after the summer, and we're going to be diving into Galatians as well. If you're part of a home group, maybe you've kind of dipped off, let me encourage you, get back involved in them. If you're not part of a home group and you're thinking, now's the time, we have so many different options in home groups. You can meet via Zoom, you can meet in person. There's lots of different home groups with different people in them, so please do go to the website and click through if you're interested, or chat to myself or one of our elders. Home groups, in essence, are one of the most valuable parts of what we do. And so we're really, really, we just want to push them and hope that the congregation understand that how important they are to us. So that's home groups. Then at the end of the service, as you kind of make your way around the outside to our fire escape doors, you'll notice some literature. At the end, we have The Voice magazine by Release International. And that's a book of stories of persecuted Christians around the world. There's some really, it's not a fun bedtime read, but it is a really great read. And as I read it last night, it really is very poignant. So let me encourage you, if there's not enough of them, we can get more of them. And there's also some other literature at the back, just to let you know about what's happening beyond our own little bubble in Carrickfergus. So thank you for those. Mums, if you need a space, we have the prayer room just at the back, and we also have the kitchen. So if you need a space just to get away or anything like that, and I'm just really just saying this to my own wife, so she knows where to go. But babies and kids are so welcome here. Please don't worry about noise. It's just if you need a space, you can make use of those. Let's come to God in prayer as we come before the Lord. Lord, we are in such a really weird season. Every day on the news, we look out for certain numbers. Numbers of new deaths, new infections. Numbers of people near us. Numbers around the world. Lord, we are so in the dark about when this will end, how it will end, what the future brings. And at times it can feel very helpless when all we really have is a mask and we're called to go out the door. Lord, in these times, help us not to forget that the gospel of Jesus Christ, that you have redeemed us, given us an inheritance. All of these things, that they do not leave us, but they are firmly secured for us in good times and in bad, in pandemic times and in health. Lord, help us to cling to it. Help us to dwell on it. Help us to be driven by it, to share it, and to immerse ourselves in this gospel. Forgive us when we turn from this gospel to idols around us. Forgive us when we dilute the gospel, focusing more on our own merit. And instead, Lord, help us to be our returning point to you and to your word and to your spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. I feel so nervous every time I cough now because people are like, you've got to go. I'm at the tail end of a cold, so don't worry. We're in Galatians 1 today. Galatians chapter 1. And we're just going to go out of the very first 10 verses. Galatians is written to a group of three or four churches in the south of Galatia, in what was modern Greece. And you can find the story of Paul coming to these churches in Acts chapter 13 and 14. And they're a place that are very special to Paul. He's planted these churches, but something has gone wrong. Let's dive in to verse 1. Paul, an apostle, sent not from man nor by man, but by Jesus Christ and God the Father, who raised him from the dead, and all the brothers with me, to the churches in Galatia, grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, who gave himself for our sins to rescue us from the present evil age, according to the will of our God and Father, to whom be the glory forever and ever. Amen. I am astonished that you are so quickly deserting the one who called you by the grace of Christ and are turning to a different gospel, which is really no gospel at all. Evidently, some people are throwing you into confusion and are trying to pervert the gospel of Christ. But even if we or an angel from heaven should preach a gospel other than the one we preach to you, let him be eternally condemned. As we have already said, so now I say again, if anyone is preaching to you a gospel other than what you have accepted, let him be eternally condemned. Am I now trying to win the approval of men or of God? Or am I trying to please men? If I were still trying to please men, I would not be a servant of Christ. I joked with Cheryl coming in that she was going to have to do the sermon for me. Cheryl, you're ready, right? Okay. No, we're gonna get there. Galatians is written to these four churches, and Paul has brought them the most succinct gift of all, which is the gift of Jesus. The gift that he says in the very first verses, grace and peace to you. This is not just a greeting like dear John or dear Emma. This is the fundamentals of what Paul brings. Grace from Jesus and peace with the Father. Grace and peace. And this is the gospel. Grace that you cannot earn your way to heaven. Grace that you can't pour strong man powder over your life and expect it to be healthy and holy. You can't earn better membership perks and rewards in the kingdom. In fact, it has absolutely nothing to do with you. And that is what grace is about. Is that it is all to do with Jesus and nothing to do with us. That's grace. And then there's peace. Peace that we forfeited when we chose the fruit of the tree of good and evil, that we forfeited when we continued to choose idolatry, peace that we would still forfeit every time we choose a path of destruction rather than a path that honors and obeys Jesus. Grace and peace. This is the gospel. that you, as a person who believes in Jesus, you are abundant in grace and you have peace with the Father. That is not something to store on a card and put away. That is something to wear every morning of your life. It is something that whenever it is truly digested and whenever you truly soak it in, it transforms everything about your life. Paul knew that. And that's why he's so upset in the book of Galatians. Because after he leaves these churches, other teachers start to come in. Other Jewish teachers. And these Jewish teachers could not handle the message of grace and peace because it gives no glory to self. And for a lot of speakers and preachers and celebrity leaders, if there's no glory for yourself, what's the point of doing it? So how do you change subtly a gospel that is of grace and peace? Is that you start to chip away at the grace bit, and you start to chip away at the peace bit. And so what these new preachers came in, and they did two things, and these two strands are going to flow throughout the book of Galatians. They attack Paul's reputation as an apostle, and they attack the gospel. And by understanding these two words that we're going to keep coming back to, these spiral throughout the book. And that if you mine any verse in Galatians deep enough, you will find these two things as the bedrock. Paul wants his apostleship and the gospel to go hand in hand. So what were they teaching? How did they attack grace and peace? Well, they did it very simply. They said that in order for you to become a Christian, in order for you to truly be right with God, you've got to look at how our forefathers did it. And how our forefathers did it was they were circumcised. Something you did that would make you close with God. Something you could physically do to show your devotion. And so then you had this division in church between those who were the super holy people who were circumcised and who were you know, doing all the things that the Jewish custom told them. They were eating the right food and all of that. And they would look down their nose at the people who were just living by grace and peace. Now, hopefully that sounds kind of not a million miles away, because we still do that. We look at the people who do as being spiritual. We look at the people at the front as being higher. We look at certain individuals who portray themselves, and sometimes in churches, we put these obstacles of doing things, what you wear, how you speak, what your income is. You know, it's not too long ago that you had to rent out a pew, which is not so encouraging for visitors. This is all about doing, and Paul hates this. Because for him, the gospel is meant to liberate you from having to try. For him, the gospel is about getting away from the religiosity of your past, which said you had to do this, you had to dress like this, you had to keep your kids quiet, you had to do all of these things, and then you would be considered a good Christian. But this is no gospel at all. This is rubbish. And so what do they do as well? They attack who Paul is. And they say, you know, is Paul really that great? I mean, not too long ago, he was killing Christians. Who is Paul? He's not one of the 12. He wasn't there at the beginning. He's a tag along. And so Paul, right at the beginning, decides, and you know what? You got to kind of respect him, because Paul's a pretty inflammatory character. He doesn't warm up to this. What is the first words he says? Paul, an apostle. Mic drop. Paul, an apostle. That's who I am. And what we mean by an apostle, it's a very limited club of people, were those who were directly called by Jesus to go out and spread the news. And so Paul says, that is what happened to me in Damascus. On the Damascus Road, I had that calling. Jesus spoke to me and he called me. Therefore, I am an apostle. Now, you might be like, well, is it really that important who Paul is? Why is, you know, is Paul getting a wee bit braggy here? You know, okay, Paul, you're an apostle. What's the big deal? But you see, for Paul, the gospel and his identity went hand in hand. You see, Paul's saying something really interesting. He's saying, you can trust who I am because my gospel is the right gospel. And you can trust that it's the right gospel because I'm an apostle. They're a never-ending circle. If you're wondering if your preacher is called, if you're wondering about your minister or your elders or anyone is called, it's the same circle. Is what they preach Jesus? Is what they preach Jesus? And are they called by God? Paul knows that his authority is only as good as the integrity of the gospel, and that as soon as he starts preaching a different gospel, the authority goes. How do we know this? If we keep going down the passage, in verse 8, but even if we or an angel from heaven should preach a gospel other than the one we preach to you, let him be eternally condemned. You see this? So Paul's saying, my authority is good. An angel's authority is good. But even if you had an angel come down straight from heaven and they started to preach to you anything other than Jesus Christ alone, that they would be condemned. Even an angel. So it's not about him bragging. He's saying, look, my authority is only as rich as the gospel I'm talking about. And as soon as I use my authority for anything else other than to preach the gospel, it is useless. Because Paul is sent, verse 1, not from man, not to gain man's approval, not to please people, but by Jesus Christ and God the Father, who raised him from the dead. The gospel and authority go hand in hand because the gospel trumps everything. The gospel of Jesus Christ, that he has died and rose again, defeating death, is the core message. Nothing else comes close. Nothing else that you will hear about. Nothing else is worth meditating on. Nothing else is worth listening to other than this gospel. And Paul is astonished in verse 6. Why? He's astonished because of the rampant disloyalty towards the gospel. In verse 6, I am astonished that you are so quickly deserting the one who called you by the grace of Christ and are turning to a different gospel, verse 7, which is really no gospel at all. And this is a timeless thing that happens, is that we are so easily giving up the gospel of Jesus for something that is lesser. We will so easily give up Jesus for a focus on our career. A focus on our marriages, a focus on our kids. We will so easily sacrifice the gospel of Jesus for any other gospel, any other self-help book, a horoscope. We will so easily give up this thing that is the richest of treasures for so little else. Jesus talks about the kingdom of God as treasure. He talks about it as treasure that a man would go and sell everything he had just to get the gospel. When the rich man comes to Jesus, he says, "Jesus, I'm a perfect church attender. I've got the gospel thing down. I know all my catechisms. I know all my hymns. I've listened to every single one of Nathan's sermons and stayed awake. I got this Christian thing down." And Jesus says, "Brilliant. Go give away everything you have." And he's not talking about money there. What Jesus is asking him is, how much is this really worth to you? How much is the gospel really worth to you? Is it worth your everything? Because that's how valuable it is. So you can understand why Paul is so hideously upset that people are sacrificing. Whenever I was like, well, pretty much throughout, I hope Mum isn't watching this, but every Christmas, we weren't very wealthy, so, but kids don't understand that, so you always want the best thing, right? And it came to the point when iPods were released, and I just desperately wanted an iPod. And so Mum, in her infinite wisdom, was always on those like QVC channels that like were like, if you buy a phone package, you get some really cheapy, like iPad, you know, like some knockoff. And Mum thought this is amazing. So every year without fail, it started with a music player that like held like four songs. And Mum thought this was amazing. And then you had to pretend it was amazing the entire time. And then whenever the iPads came out, I didn't even expect an iPad, but I got a pad of some description that is still in our garage, gathering dust, and that Mum just looks at every now and then and goes, the difference in quality between these two things was so great that why would anyone ever settle for something less? Why would we ever settle for something less? And we're not just talking about things outside of church like money and all the other idols that the world in this evil age, as Paul says, are propelling towards us. But we do it so often in church. That was what Paul was most annoyed about. Paul was most annoyed was that not that people were going after sex and money, but he was annoyed that they'd taken something really pure like Jesus and had said, Jesus loves you and saves you if you do this. And as soon as you do that, it becomes about you and not about Jesus. And as soon as it becomes about you, it means that you can lose it. It means if you have a bad day, your faith is in a bad position. It means if you muck up, your faith is, well, where is it? As soon as the gospel depends on you, it's done. It's trash. Throw it out. It's gone. Loyalty to this gospel is the calling of the Christian. And if you want a briefer, if you want a brief on loyalty to the faith, read this. Read this. There's a pastor in this book from Pakistan. He's not much older than I am. And he was given 6 days jail, just like that, for daring to speak out in defense of other Christians. 6 days, just like that. That's my job. You know, my biggest worry this week is how long session will take tomorrow night. But that's a guy whose loyalty would take him to prison. And around the world, loyalty does not mean just even coming to church, reading your Bible. Loyalty is about life and death. People will die today because they will not renounce Jesus. It's not even that they believe in Jesus, because they'll probably be given a chance to renounce. People will leave their communities. People will leave marriages because they'll be thrown out because they found Jesus. This is not some kind of social experiment game that we play in Carrickfergus. This is something that is so serious that people are dying for. And I'm not saying that to you, to guilt you. Because again, that's what churches can do. Can try to guilt you into feeling like, oh, I really should give this more of a go or something like this. No. Guilt is a really poor motivator. And maybe it'll catch you to tomorrow, but by tomorrow you'll probably have forgotten what I say. No, the motivator for this is not guilt, but it is glory. You see, the gospel, why will people die for this gospel? They won't die because of guilt. They won't die because of fear. They will die because their heart of hearts is to bring glory to the Father. Verse 5, after Paul has described the gospel, he says, to whom be the glory forever and ever. Verse 10, am I trying to win the approval of men or of God, or am I trying to please men? If I were still trying to please men, I would not be a servant of Christ. And that's the truth. If you're in this for human approval, you're in the wrong place. If you're in this for community prestige, if you're in this for rank or file, this is not the place for you. There are lots of membership clubs that will fit you just down to the ground, but this is not the place. Because this is a place where we join with brothers and sisters whose one goal today is when they are asked the question, who is the King of Kings? Who is Lord? Knowing that the answer to that could determine the fate of their families, of their communities, of themselves. And they answer unequivocally, Jesus. This is what brings glory to the Father. I want every day that I wake up for my goal to be, how do I glorify the Lord through my parenting, through my husbanding, through my preaching? I want, whenever I get to heaven, for the sum total of my life to not be about how many people came to faith, how much teaching I did, but my life would be about bringing glory to God the Father. Will you join me in that? Not because of guilt, but because you love God. And you respond to his gift of life because you know the joy that it is to have the assurance of eternity because you love him. And if you love him, the goal is to bring him glory. And everything else fades. Everything else fades. Let's pray. Father God, for those who will suffer today because they have called on the name of Jesus as King above all kings, we pray, Lord, that you would strengthen them even now. Lord, we pray that their sacrifices would not be wasted on us, but instead would strengthen our conviction, that they would provoke us to prayer, that their blood would not go unanswered. Lord, sometimes we need to be shaken from what's going on around us. Instead, we pray that you would help us to look up, and that no matter what we do as a church, or as individuals, we would seek to bring you glory forever and ever. Amen. to invite the band up, and you're invited to stand and to sing, and then we'll share the benediction. A note to say that we have prayer ministry. If you'd like to stay in your seats or indeed online, you can find all the details about that after the service. And now we share the benediction together. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.